Almost every service we've mentioned in this class can be moved off to another machine, and many can be made into redundant services. With this in mind, let's go through each component and under what conditions we'd expand our system and add more machines. We're not going to do all of this in class, but it's good to go through what our decision process would be if we wanted to make our system larger. The architecture we ended up with in this class is fairly close to what you'd see in a smaller production system, minus the fact that we're using a single SQL Express server, we've mentioned that already, and we're only using a single interface instance. If this was a real production system, my eyes would widen and I wouldn't close them until I had a redundant interface instance running. In a real system, we'd have lots of different types of interfaces, and each one would be set up as a redundant pair in uni-int failover. We might have some connectors thrown in there as well. If you're interested in connectors, I'll throw some documentation over to the side. So we covered uni-int failover in the basics class, but this is how it interacts with PyData Archive collectives. If we were to add another interface machine to our infrastructure here, let's call it PyInt02, the setup here would be exactly the same as in the basics class, except one very small difference. In the ICU under the Py host information, we'd set the SDK member to PySIV02. This makes the interface pair slightly more robust if there's an outage. Okay, so we have both interfaces set up and buffering to both servers. We'll assume that we're using hot failover here. In hot failover, both interfaces are reading from the source at all times, but only one of them is sending data to both data archives. If the interface can't connect to one of the data archives, it'll buffer data for that archive, but continue to send data to the other one. Once it comes back, the buffer will flow through. If the primary interface goes offline, the backup will start sending data to both collective members straight away. With this whole setup, you'd be able to have up to two failures, one interface and one data archive, and still have zero data loss and 100% uptime for users. Okay, let's talk about making other improvements to our system. The first improvement we'd make would be for performance reasons, and we'd move the analysis service away from the data archive service. The reason why we'd do this is to alleviate resource contention. We see this if analysis calculations are running behind and it's struggling to keep up. And you'd know this was happening if users were complaining to you that they're not seeing their calculation results where they're meant to be, or the analysis service is taking a noticeable amount of memory and CPU resources away from the data archive. To move the service off, we'd stop the analysis service on our data archive, then install the analysis service on the new machine by running the PyServer install kit, set it up, then do a little configuration and set up buffering. See the documentation referenced on this lesson for more information. This will make our architecture more into a recommended topology, and it's fairly close to most Py systems I see out there in the wild. If you determine that the analysis service is business critical and uptime is a high priority, you need to use Windows failover clustering if you want redundancy here. See the references for details on that. The next move that makes sense would probably be moving asset framework away from the data archive servers. We'd do this if users were using the RTQP engine to query data. The RTQP engine needs to be installed on the same machine as the AF server. The RTQP engine is pretty heavy on resource consumption, and it'll compete for the data archive for memory use if it's installed on the same machine. To move our AF servers off, we'd install AF servers on new hardware and then point the network load balancer to the new AF servers. Then we'd remove the services from PySIV01 and PySIV02 and remove their records from the network load balancer. Easy. The other benefit we get here, apart from performance, is security. We can now remove our AF servers from the DMZ network between our corporate network and our process control network. AF really doesn't need to be in a DMZ because it doesn't connect downstream. The less services we have installed close to the process control network, the lower our attack surface, and the better we're doing. Now let's talk about adding more data archives. First off, we'll talk about accessibility. The golden rules with server placement are keep interfaces as close to the data source as possible and keep Py servers as close to the users as possible. When I say close here, I mean both geographically and from a network standpoint. So if we have a remote site with a shaky network, for example, an offshore oil platform, and site users need PI data in their control rooms for critical operations, and our network is unreliable between our site and our corporate headquarters, we might consider having a data archive on site and another one in our corporate headquarters. Now, you'd think we could use a data archive collective here, but collectives are intended to be in a similar geographic location. High latency or lots of packet loss between them tends to make them fall out of sync, and you need to reinitialize them with a collective manager. Most of the time, you wouldn't want a collective that spans between corporate and site. Not to mention, they'd probably be on different domains and require different security configuration, and collectives synchronize their security settings, so it probably won't work for you. In this scenario, we usually set up a PI-to-PI interface or a PI system connector. These services are similar in function to the OPC interface we know and love, but don't use an OPC server as a data source. They use a PI data archive as a data source. They read data coming in to tags on one data archive and push it all to tags on another data archive. So we've just added another PI data archive for accessibility reasons. What about performance? If your system is tall, well, tall meaning approaching hundreds of thousands of events per second coming in, you'd get that if you're using synchrophases, or the system is wide, approaching tens of millions of tags. Examples of this would be if you're using a PI data archive to store data from lots of wellheads or large solar farms. You should consider spreading your tags across multiple data archives. There's not much to say here regarding configuration. You'd have to maintain the servers independently and have different interface instances running to different data archives. Next, PI Vision. We didn't install PI Vision in this class. You can see directions on how to do that on the side if you want to. But PI Vision's a web application running on Windows IIS. You install it on a server, point it to a SQL backend that stores all the displays that users make, and then tell it which data archives and which AF servers it should make available to users. If you want it to be highly available, you just install more than one. Point them both at the same SQL backend and the same data archive and asset framework servers, and stick a network load balancer between the Vision servers and the users. Now, the next question we usually get is, can I put PI Vision on the internet? It's a web app, so I can just put it on the internet, right? Well, yeah, you can. But it reaches down into the PI data archive, into critical business resources. So any normal security and rules your organization should have for something like this should be respected. Most likely, you'd put your Vision server in its own DMZ between the corporate network and the nasty, dangerous internet over there. It's a wild west out there. Talk to your IT department for more recommendations. I'm sure they'll have them. The good thing here is that PI Vision itself isn't too different from many other corporate web applications, and you should be able to work out a solution with IT. And lastly, one day, if it hasn't happened already, a data scientist is going to come and ask you how to get data out of the PI system. You're going to ask them what data you want and in what format, and they're going to say, oh, I want all the data. In a .txt file, it's something like that. You'll have noticed by now that the whole PI data archive is designed around efficient storage and delivery of production data. And sticking the whole thing into a text file isn't a really simple or even achievable task for even a small system. Let's talk about how your friends in data science should be getting data out of the system. They have a few choices here. They can get data out through our developer technologies, most commonly by executing SQL queries against the RTQP engine service on the asset framework server, or by running PI-AF SDK inside of Python or something like that. For exactly how to use these technologies, check out our developer learning path, linked in the references. These options can work, but it'll most likely result in huge performance drops for other users while data is being extracted. A safer option is probably the PI Integrator for Business Analytics. This is a service you install on a machine that makes scheduled queries for data from Asset Framework and Data Archive and saves that data in tables or text files, or just streams it to the cloud. This solution is preferable because you've got control over the load on the system. you can determine how often the data is updated, and it's made to efficiently extract a large amount of data and save it for access in exactly the format that your data science friends want. And that's about all I wanted to talk about here. There are many more components in the Pi system. I recommend taking a look at the documentation or making a post in the community if you have any questions on additional features or capabilities.